Welcome once again, brothers and sisters. So we continue with the teaching on our theme for the year 2022. Our topic, therefore, is abundant life in Christ Jesus. Abundant life in Christ Jesus. Let's open our Bibles to the text and read it together. John chapter 10, verse 10b. I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. I have come, Jesus spoke here, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Our second scripture is 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of our Lord Jesus Christ, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. The Almighty God bless his word in Jesus' mighty name. Last week, we started the journey of this teaching. And for those who didn't join, please, I encourage you to get hold of the video. It's titled Abundant Life in Christ Jesus, Part 2. But that's where we really started the teaching itself. And we established that abundant life is life that is more than enough. Hallelujah. More than enough supply and provisions. It is unlimited and unending life. That includes eternal life. That is life beyond this world. So abundant life is the life of God that God has provided for us to enjoy all his provisions and blessings here in this world and beyond this world. Spend that eternity with him. Beloved, God's divine life has been given to us. His divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. If you are sick, his divine power will heal you. If you are oppressed, his divine power will deliver you and set you free. If you lack, it will supply all your needs. Like Paul said, my God will supply all your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. The same Paul also said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Here Paul again affirmed that by this divine power, we have everything pertaining to life and godliness. This divine life gives us joy, peace, love, fulfillment, all things indeed pertaining to life and godliness. Glory be to Jesus, our Lord and Savior, the one through whom we have received this divine life, the one through whom we have access to this divine life. And so Jesus said very boldly in that John chapter 10, verse 10b, I have come that you may have life, that I may have life, that we may have life, and have it how? More abundantly. So abundant life in Christ Jesus is your portion, my brothers and sisters. Abundant life in Christ Jesus is my portion. All glory be to Jesus and the Almighty God the Father. Forever. Amen. Want to continue looking deeper into this? From the text, just a recap. These two texts put together, it is clear, as we established last Sunday, that's in the last teaching, that abundant life is through Jesus Christ. It's only through Jesus Christ, the one who has said, I have come to give abundant life, that we can have this abundant life. Number two, those who receive Jesus, therefore, God gives them the divine nature, the divine nature. Number three, that by this divine nature, we escaped the corruption of the world and have also received the divine power which produces the divine life, that is, gives us all things that pertain to life and godliness, just as we have said. So we want to explore who Jesus is that enables him to give abundant life, to make this bold statement. And we want to hear what he says, how we should live that we may gain this abundant life. And we want to do this by exploring the synoptic gospels. And we are studying the book of Matthew. We have studied so far individually, personally, up to Matthew chapter 23, which is today, Matthew chapter 23. That's where we are today. But in this joint discussion, we're going to go back and continue progressing from Matthew chapter 1, which is where we stopped last time. So Matthew, as we have learned, aims to show that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Messiah. And that carries a lot as a Christian. Because from now, you will go back and study from the law and the prophets and the early Christians as recorded in Acts of the Apostle and then the letters, including what is written in the gospel, what the Messiah has said and what is about the Messiah. If you can understand that, then having been convinced totally that this Jesus is the Messiah, then everything follows. That whatever was said about the Messiah concerning you is real and is true. Glory be to God. You know, in mathematics, we often say if A equals to B and B equals to C, then you can also say that A and C are equal, isn't it? If A equals to B and B equals to C, you can also say that A and C are equal. So that's what we want to do. Let's quickly look at Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. I will not be able to run through every text there, so you read it again. But it summarizes, or it is a summary of the birth of Jesus Christ. And let me bring some key points there. Again, it's all about showing us that this Jesus is the Messiah. And therefore, everything that was said about the Messiah applies to your life, applies to me. And whatever this Messiah has said, we must do it. Must. And whatever this Messiah has done while he was here and has continued to do in the lives of others, which is what the letters from Acts of the Apostle to 3 John and Jude has spoken, then you enter into Revelation, which is what Jesus himself revealed to John the Beloved. All that is written is meant for you and I to come and enjoy this eternal life. So summarize it again, whatever this Messiah has said we should do, that we must do. Whatever the Messiah has done, that we must do. Hallelujah. Whatever the Bible has shown us about this Messiah, which he has also done in the lives of others, we know it is for us. Glory be to God. So, key points from that verse 18 to 25, because from verses 1 through verses 1 through 17, we have established the genealogy of Jesus and the importance of that in the root of the Messiah. The Messiah is the seed of Abraham. He is the son of David that was prophesied throughout the prophets, especially during the time of the captivity in Babylon. From verse 18 to 25 then, point one to make is that he was conceived of the Holy Spirit, and the angel of God announced and confirmed this. So this was confirmed by angel. So he was conceived of the Holy Spirit, and this was confirmed by the angel, as you will see in Luke chapter 1, verse 35, and also in this Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 and 20. Point number two, his birth and name, Emmanuel, meaning God with us, was prophesied. That was part of the prophecies in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Isaiah prophesied there and said, a virgin shall conceive and shall bring forth a child and shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. This Messiah, as was prophesied to be born by a virgin, was fulfilled. Glory be to God. Point number three, which I've already said, his name is Emmanuel, God with us. And that's very important. Remember, we said pay attention to who he is, what he says we should do, and what he has done, that we may copy and do exactly as he has done. So, Emmanuel, meaning God with us, that is his name. His name also is Jesus, meaning Savior. And this name was given by angel. Number four, all the prophecies and events of his birth confirmed he is the Messiah. All the prophecies and events of his birth confirmed he is the Messiah. We've already mentioned Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. If you go to Micah chapter 5, verse 2, Micah 5, verse 2, you will see the prophecy there. Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Let's quickly look at that. It said, but you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are from of old, from everlasting. It's only the Messiah that is from of old and yet born at the appointed time. Glory be to God, and is from everlasting. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15, 18 and 19. While you're opening to that, let me first read Acts of the Apostle, chapter 3, verse 22 and 23, where Peter, on that special day that we call the day of Pentecost, declared concerning Jesus. It says, verse 22, Acts chapter 3, verses 22 and 23, say, for Moses truly said to the fathers, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he says to you. And it shall be that every soul who will not hear that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. Let me just add 24. He said, yes, all the prophets from Samuel and those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold of this day. So all the prophets spoke about who? Jesus. They spoke about who? This Messiah. Deuteronomy chapter 18, 15, and then 18 and 19. Deuteronomy chapter 18, 15, and then we'll read 18 and 19. I read, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren. Him you shall hear. This was Moses speaking, which is what Apostle Peter quoted in Acts chapter 3, verses 22 and 23 that we saw. So verses 18 and 19, read it with me. In fact, let's read from 17, which is what Moses said. He said, and the Lord said to me, what they have spoken is good. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren, and will put my words in his mouth. Can you see that? So whatever this Messiah says, you should do that, you must do. You want to enjoy abundant life. So now you get the key. It is by doing everything that comes out of the mouth of God, which the Messiah, Jesus Christ, the Savior, Emmanuel, God with us, the Redeemer of mankind, the Son of the living God, has spoken to us, and they are written down in the gospel, in the Acts of the Apostles, in the letters, all the way to Revelation, and in the prophets, as written, as called Old Testament. So I read that verse 18 and 19 again. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him, all that God has commanded us to be, to do, to have. Jesus has spoken them and has done them. 19, and it shall be that whoever will not hear my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it of him. So, my brothers and sisters, you ask me, how do I enjoy abundant life? By doing every word that Jesus has spoken, and by copying him, Jesus, to be like him. Because we have been given the Spirit of God to be sons and daughters of God, to have the ability to be like Jesus Christ. That's what it means to be a Christian. However, when we say to be like Jesus in all aspects, to manifest Jesus Christ in our lives, to copy him, and to do all that he has done as example, note that we are to do this as children of God, with understanding that we are the children of God, not as Jews. Hello. So again, pay attention when you're reading the Synoptic Gospels. Remember, Jesus is a Jew. There are things he did as a Jew, yet as being the Son of God, the Son of God. And so you must understand also this right balance of what he did in order to fulfill his humanity as a Jew at the time he came, and what he did as a son or the Son of God, which is what we are to listen to and to copy. And he has made all this clear to us. So, having summarized chapter 1 and having set the context, let's look at chapter 2. I captioned the summary of chapter 2 of Matthew as fulfillment of the prophecies of the birth of the Messiah. Fulfillment of the prophecies of the birth of the Messiah. So, and these are also witnesses to that fulfillment. Number one, key point to take from chapter 2 is that wise men from the east confirmed he was born king of the Jews. Wise men from the east, they came and they confirmed that Jesus was born king of the Jews. You can read that from chapter 2. Let's quickly read it. Say, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? Because it was prophesied that this Messiah that is born, he is the king of the Jews. Now you will see the confusion as you read through, because the Jews then thought, okay, this Messiah, this king that is born, will physically take over and deliver them from the physical oppression. But Jesus will help us understand what that meant. He is the king of the Jews. He is the king of kings. He is the Lord of lords. Glory be to God. Number 2 point, Herod and chief priests and scribes confirmed the prophecy of his place of birth, which is Bethlehem. You see that in verse 6, Matthew chapter 2, verse 6. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. Do you see that? Shepherd my people, Israel. Micah chapter 5, verse 2, that we read earlier, confirmed that as well. Number 3, Herod represented the devil. Herod here represented the devil. In fact, he was instigated by the devil. Because once the wise men announced that the Messiah has been born as prophesied, Herod went wild. So Herod represented the devil and the power of darkness, the devil and darkness. And what did they do? They tried to destroy God's plan. Even as a child, God ensured Jesus Christ was protected and delivered him from evil and power of darkness. Note this point again. Herod represents the devil and darkness, which tried to destroy God's plan until today. That's what the devil is about. The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus Christ, the Messiah, has come to give you, give me, give all humankind life and life in abundance. Now, what does this teach us? It teaches us that we, as children of God, no matter what the devil does, no matter what darkness may try to do, be resolute and strong in faith in God. Because the same way God delivers his son, even as a baby, from the power of darkness and from the satanic agent called Herod, so God will deliver his children. The same way God will continue to protect and deliver all his children from the power of darkness and all evil. Psalm 91 verse 10 says that he will deliver us. Amen. Hallelujah. It says no matter what the plague is, he will deliver us. There shall no evil befall us, neither shall any plague come nigh our dwelling. For he will give his angels charge over us. They will, in their hands, they will bear us up. They will not allow us to dash our foot against a stone in any way we go. May that be your portion. May that be my portion. Whatever oppression there is in your life, there is in my life, there is in our families, may the power of the Most High deliver us. May that oppression cease to function in the name of Jesus Christ. Be strong in faith. There shall no power of darkness overcome you. God will make a way for you in the mighty name of Jesus. Beloved brothers and sisters, in the fight of darkness against the light, because darkness will always fight against the light, Note this, that many atrocities will continue to happen. Such is the state of the world, even as it is now. So when Jesus was born, darkness began to fight. And that fight resulted in the killing of all children that were age 2 and below. They killed them. But God delivered his son. The Almighty God will deliver you. In the midst of pandemic, God will deliver you. In the midst of terrorist attacks, God will deliver you and your family. In the mighty name of Jesus, fear not. Just give your life to Jesus, the Messiah. Oh, glory be to God. God will keep you. God will keep me. God will keep us. In the name of Jesus. So, Jesus Christ, what has he taught us about this? He says, only in me you will have peace. In the world, you will have tribulations. It's only in Jesus you have peace. Trouble will continue to happen in the world. Those who try to say war, peace, yes, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. God said we should pray. Pray for the peace of wherever you are is the right thing to do. But if you think that any man, anybody, any organization has power to give peace to the world, then you have missed it completely. The world will continue to have trouble. Trouble and trouble and trouble will come because there is a continuous fight between darkness and light from the time Jesus came into the world. If I even before then, since God brought light into the world, darkness has continued to fight. But in this fight of darkness against light, light has overcome and light will continue to overcome. And so if you are light, know that darkness has fallen already before you in the mighty name of Jesus. Look with me to what Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 27, John 14, 27. John chapter 14, verse 27. Remember, whatever he says, that is what we must do. This Messiah, John 14, 27. Let's read it together. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. John chapter 16, verse 33. John 16, verse 33. These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus is the only one that gives peace. Darkness will continue to fight. But Jesus, the Messiah, has given us peace. Only in him we have peace. And that peace is guaranteed. Victory is guaranteed over every error, no matter the atrocities that the devil will cause. So now you have understanding why that evil decision that men take, or evil decisions that men take, are cause so much atrocities, cause so much pain. I believe by now we are living witnesses that mankind does not have the power to rule himself, talk less of ruling others. Ruling is the prerogative of God, is the reserve of God. God hasn't given any human being the right to rule over another. He only delegates power. And he warns when he delegates that power that we should not lord over another. We are brethren. We are equal. We are to serve one another in humility as a little child, which we emphasized in the last teaching. We are to lead like Jesus led. He was a servant leader. We will come to that. So, summary is Jesus Christ is the Messiah, confirmed by angels, confirmed by prophecies, also confirmed John the Baptist was a witness. That's chapter 3. I'm already entering into chapter 3, but I'll leave that. Now, everything he says we must do. Today, the key thing he has said to us is that in him we have peace. In the world, there will continue to be trouble. The key thing he says to us is that in him we have victory. Despite the trouble that darkness and the satanic agents in all manner of form and guises will continue to perpetrate in the world, Jesus is the Prince of Peace and will continue to give us peace and give us victory as long as we are in him. God bless you. Chapter 3, I captioned chapter 3, John the Baptist as witness to the Messiah. John the Baptist as witness to the Messiah. So John was given the baptism of repentance to prepare the way for the Messiah. And this was prophesied according to prophecy, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, Malachi 4, 5, and 6. You also see this in Luke chapter 1, verse 17. So that's chapter 3, verse 3. Chapter 3, it says, "For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Point two, this is chapter 3 now. John confirmed Jesus Christ is the Messiah who will baptize the people with the Holy Spirit and fire. Verses 11 and 12. Let's look at that. "I indeed," that's Matthew chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. "I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." Verse 12. "His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenching fire." This was John the Baptist. He continued. John the Baptist also called him mightier than I. As you can see there, he said in that verse 11, he's mightier than I. If you go to the Luke part of it, I believe there he made a more elaborate statement about Jesus. It says, "Whose shoe latches I'm not worthy to untie." So Jesus had baptism of repentance. Notice, baptism of repentance to fulfill all righteousness. So to keep to the law, to keep to what was prophesied, that John will come to prepare the way. And John used the baptism of repentance to prepare the people for the Messiah. So the Messiah himself submitted himself for that baptism. And Jesus said that it was for all requirements to be fulfilled, for all requirements to be fulfilled. So again, he also shows that it's important for Christians to have baptism. But that baptism is baptism into Christ, baptism into Christ, baptism into life. So we are buried into the death of Jesus Christ and we are raised with him into life. His resurrection is baptism into Christ. Number 4 point, and of course, is again also very important that you do the baptism properly. So a story is told of some people who put water in their vestries and in different places. I believe there were such water around Jerusalem and Galilee and all that at that time Jesus was around. If the intention of baptism was to for people to use water and rub you, rub themselves, or put water in their own swimming pool and baptize people, then Jesus would have done it. But I think all that aren't correct. They are not right. So be careful where you submit yourself to be baptized. Because some people have put their shrines in their houses and in their vestries and called it water for baptism. Don't go and submit your head to what you don't know. Go to the natural water and let a man of God that is filled with the Holy Spirit, that has the testimony of Jesus Christ, baptize you. Not by cajoling and words of mouth, sweet talks, as we would see, but that the Spirit conviction is there that this is a child of God. So next point, point four. I believe that's it for baptism. I believe we can take that. Point four, the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus and God called him beloved son, beloved son. So God also confirmed that Jesus is that Messiah, is his beloved son. Glory be to God. These are the key points of chapter three. We want to pray. We want to pray. We want to ask the Spirit of God to help us. We want to ask God, help me by your Spirit. Teach me to hear, to listen, to understand what the Messiah has spoken, and help me to do as he has done. Beloved brothers and sisters, you talk about the gap in our reality versus the promise of God for us to enjoy abundant life. This is where it lies. How much do you know of what the Messiah has said we should do? And how much of it do you do? This is where the gap is. So we're going to pray. We are closing now. So we're going to pray and say, Heavenly Father, help me by your Spirit to do your will. Go ahead and pray. Talk to God now. You have heard the word. You have heard the word. Jesus is the Messiah. And whatever the Messiah says we should do, that we must do. Whatever he has done, that we will do. Now go ahead and pray. Father God, give me the grace. It's a personal prayer now. This is where the gap lies. Are you ready to do what God has spoken through his son that we should do, that you should do, that I should do? If you have not given your life to Jesus and you would like to give your life to Jesus now, just go ahead and tell him, Lord Jesus, I now know you are the Messiah, the Savior. Your name is Emmanuel, God with me. Now I surrender my life to you. I repent of my sins, and I ask Almighty God, give me your Holy Spirit now and forgive me all my sins. Transform my life by the power of your Holy Spirit. Help me from today to live according to your word, every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, as the Messiah, the Son of the living God, has spoken and has lived for an example unto us. Thank you, our Lord and our God. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word that you have taught us today. You have confirmed to us Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, is the promised Messiah who has come into the world and has fulfilled all that God Almighty you set for him to fulfill, and thereby redeem us, save us, deliver us, reconcile us unto God, and make us sons and daughters of God. Heavenly Father, we agree together and ask, Lord, please, by your Spirit, give us the grace, give us the strength to do your will. And we pray, Lord, that all the promise of the abundant life that you have promised us will manifest in our lives and our families now and forevermore. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen.